Boa noite. Eu sei que é um dia de semana, todos estamos cansados, viemos direto do trabalho para cá. Eu quero dar as boas-vindas a todos. Meu nome é Hartmut Glaser, eu sou o secretário executivo do CGI e nós estamos esse ano celebrando 20 anos de existência, de trabalho, de realização. E o CGI no Brasil, para quem não conhece, é um modelo multissetorial, plurirepresentativo de vários setores da nossa sociedade brasileira. Nós temos hoje, no Comitê Gestor, 21 conselheiros, muitos estão aqui presentes. Dos 21, 9 representam o governo e 12 representam a sociedade civil, tanto o setor acadêmico como o setor empresarial, como as ONGs, o terceiro setor. E esse modelo, ele começou no Brasil em 95, antes que outros já falassem nesse momento, nesse modelo também. Quando o ICANN, em 98, iniciou sua organização e falou em multi-stakeholder, nós já tínhamos 3 ou 4 anos de experiência. E hoje esse tema é um tema internacional. E nesta semana estamos realizando aqui na sala ao lado um curso sobre governança da internet. Nós temos aqui 37 alunos, temos um grande grupo de professores, tanto conselheiros como pessoas convidadas, tentando passar toda essa informação e esse conhecimento à nova geração. Eu sempre me defino já como um dos jurássicos, um dos mais velhos da história aqui no Brasil. Temos outros também que talvez se ofendem, mas, de qualquer forma, a história vai correndo e a gente, então, está preparando uma nova liderança para realmente assumir e continuar esse trabalho. E é um prazer muito, muito grande, no meio deste evento, celebrar mais um degrau dos 20 anos de história do CGI. Nós decidimos que este ano seria um ano de festa, o ano todo. Quando uma coisa é importante, ter apenas um momento é muito pouco. Em maio começamos com as nossas festas e em cada evento que estamos realizando este ano, tratamos de um tema, de um dos princípios que nós aprovamos no CGI em 2009. Hoje, o assunto principal é inovação. E temos a honra de ter 2 palestrantes internacionais que vieram especialmente para brilhantar esta noite e essa discussão. Nós vamos pedir que os 2 se apresentem, ou apresentem o seu discurso, a sua palestra, em 40 minutos, aproximadamente, cada um, e depois teremos um debate com todo o plenário. E como nós não queremos perder tempo com blá, 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 vamos ao que é mais sério, e que é o conteúdo. Então, mais uma vez, bem-vindos. E, para mim, então, é uma honra apresentar o primeiro palestrante, que é o Dr. John Clancy. Ele é consultor independente de arquitetura da internet da AT&T, atuou já no passado na MCI, na WorldCom, trabalhou no MIT e é hoje um membro sênior do IEEE e da Internet Society, além da Associação Americana de Estatística e da Associação Internacional para a Computação Estatística. Foi um dos responsáveis pela definição do sistema de nome de domínio, conhecido como DNS, e participou na transição da IEC e da USC, que deu origem à ICANN, toda a história que nós ouvimos também aqui no curso nestes dias. Por mais de 30 anos, como técnico, participou da padronização e da formulação de mais de 40 RFCs, Request for Comments, incluindo o que deu origem ao protocolo SMTP. Com essa apresentação, eu quero convidá-lo a proferir a sua palestra. I'd like to invite you, John Clancy, welcome in Brazil for the first speech. Welcome, and now we will listen what you have to say.
Thank you very much for the introduction. My background is confusing. I hope it was less confusing to you in Portuguese than it was to me in English. But I, am happy to move forward from there. Internet innovation is not really my main area. I've been working in the last several years primarily in areas of internationalization and in naming and identifiers. But I found it more convenient to be here for this meeting than at others, so I seem to be talking about innovation. In talking with others yesterday, I realized that what I had decided to talk about wasn't what you probably wanted expected to hear. So as background, there are two standard innovation talks. I'm not giving either of them, but they're worth mentioning. And worth mentioning just to set context. So I've reduced those two talks to one slide each. The first one is about permissionless innovation. Most of the historical communications networks prior to the internet were centrally controlled, usually SMART, that's a technical term, in the telephone business at least. The new applications had to be made part of the network switching arrangements, and new applications could interfere with older ones, and that meant that applications needed to be tested and carefully vetted and cleared before they could be used properly in the network. And the telephone system is the classic example of this kind of situation. With the understanding that telephones, at least at the time that these discussions were starting, tended to be very stupid instruments. The internet turns the model around. We have a dumb network with smart terminals and endpoints. The net doesn't know what it is carrying, and that is a point we'll be coming back to. New applications require only support on relevant endpoints, not in the middle or in places who don't intend to use them. And that the network also assumes packet level routing, which is a whole different talk. The other discussion under innovation has to do with putting intelligent boxes in the network and what to do about them. They violate the dumb network assumption that I just talked about. They do allow some things dumb networks can't support. Some of those things are things that some of us wish couldn't be supported. They allow charging differently or charging different parties for different applications and kinds of traffic. I mentioned a conversation earlier today that in the telephone environment, several of the PTTs in the 70s decided to start charging differently for fax than for telephone because you could transmit more information in a minute of fax transmission than in a minute of voice, and they thought they should be able to charge for the information flow or the content rather than the time. And that was just completely something that that the internet wanted to avoid for many reasons. These intelligent boxes also create some interesting business model issues, again, part of a different talk. And for those of you who are worried about IPv6, the IPv6 transition process has become part of the problem. So now I'm going to move on to the talk I thought I was giving about internet innovation and the importance of the sequencing and timing and deployment issues in actually getting innovations out there. There's always a fundamental question about what we mean by innovation in this environment. So the question is whether it's the actual invention of something new, incremental improvements. Dr. David Clark at MIT gave a talk a number of years ago when he mentioned that in physics, people are fond of pointing out that their new and important developments are a consequence of standing on the shoulders of giants who had come before. And Clark made the observation, which many of us find some resonance with, that in certain areas of computer science and networking, we tend to seek out the giants and find them and then stand on their feet, not their shoulders. So one of the important questions is how long do things take? And I'm going to spend time this evening talking about some examples of how long things take after what we might reasonably think of as the innovations have occurred. Or alternatively, how long it takes after everything is in place before the innovations occur. Development and deployment tends to depend on some very odd gating factors. I'm going to mention some of the odder ones tonight. And my first example will be about when the web itself was an innovation and why it was an innovation at that time. One of the things which we have learned repeatedly is that innovations and deployment of innovations is much easier when one is filling a vacuum, something has never been there before, than if you're trying to improve an existing environment in a way which forcibly is incompatible. Sometimes it's in part to tell those two cases apart until you see what's going on. As I say, we'll look at some examples. So the first example is the innovation of the invention of the web, or what we now call the web. Most of the fundamental ideas were in a paper that Vannevar Bush published in 1945. Looking around this room, I would suggest that most of you were very young then. I was very young then. We had no networks. The computers we had were insufficient to the job and very big. Not big in processing power, but big in rooms. But the ideas are still in the paper. The fundamental ideas for generic markup came out of work done by Tunnicliffe and slightly later Goldfarb in around 69. They did the work which led directly to HTML, and HTML is an SGML dialect. Whether that makes it an invention or not depends upon who you are and what you're trying to prove. Nelson and Engelbart came along and did some fundamental work on hypertext. Nelson's work at Brown by 1969 had hypertext with pen input. Light pens themselves date from the Whirlwind computer, which is one of those very early things, even before my time, circa 1955. Engelbart's group at the Stanford Research Institute was responsible for a system first called NLS and then called Augment. It's fundamental development of the ARPANET and a lot of its initial documentation, and for some devices which you may have heard about, like mice. GUIs, graphical user interfaces, date to much earlier. Improvements in Engelbart's group, but the developments came probably 15 years earlier. The publications about hypertext, which are separate from the Engelbart and Nelson work and these other threads around 1988. There's a major MIT Press book, 1988, on text and hypertext and context that doesn't even mention the work going on the internet at that point. So against this background, work going back to 1945, the web was invented in 1990. And this is part of what I mean about these long chains of development starting by ending at a breakthrough, or the breakthrough occurring later. Not the only example. So what happened in the 1990s which caused the web to deploy when these earlier technologies did not? And how much do they have to do with the web versus the earlier technologies versus other things which were going on? Well, one of the things which happened in the early 90s is that modems went up to V32 bis and V34. Which got the modem speeds up above 20K or thereabouts, that's bits. And that made it possible to run packets over the network, over a dial-up connection. Having run packets 10 years earlier over a dial-up connection to 2400 baud, it is an experience you would not like. Moving to graphical interfaces, again, the graphical interfaces started in the 1970s, so putting one on top of the web was fairly obvious. Doing it was an interesting challenge, but the idea was fairly obvious. And the other thing which happened is that the appropriate use policies, which kept everybody off the network, except those who were lucky enough, started to end, starting in the late 80s and through the early half of the 90s. So the web came together not as a consequence of the web being an important invention and innovation in 1990, but because by the time that version of the innovation came along, we had the modem infrastructure, we had the GUI infrastructure, we had the computer infrastructure, we had the network availability to larger populations, and we could actually do it. There's a similar example with electronic mail. By 1989, there was considerable pressure on the IATF to standardize and allow mail messages which did not have English language ASCII content. Fairly important in Portugal, a lot more important in Russia and China and Japan. The base email standards contain no specifications for message content. That's the vacuum condition. In that work, the multimedia requirement, which people see a lot of today, was added very early. It came to dominate the discussions, but the multilingual requirement, multi-script requirement, was there all the way along. Standards were published in June of 92. Before the end of 1992, there were probably 24 implementations and a lot of messages moving conforming to this standard. Very, very rapid deployment. So the question then becomes, why so fast, especially when compared to 30 years for the web or 50 years for the web, depending on how you count? Well, there's very strong demand. As I mentioned earlier, there was no prior deployed mechanism. There was some mechanism for Japanese. But what came through made no sense unless you knew it was in Japanese, knew how it was encoded, and could read Japanese. There were no changes needed in network infrastructure, even the transport environment for the mail. And changes to the receiving mail user agent, the person who was trying to read the mail, were optional. It was difficult to read the stuff unless you had an up-to-date thing, but there were ways around that, and the transitions did occur. So there was no issue in which everybody needed to convert or nothing would work conditions. When we have those conditions, things get very hard. They were hard when we turned the internet on, but at that stage, the network environment was small and there was somebody out there who could say, if you're not converted to new protocols by this date, you will be off the net. No one can do that today. And everybody who is talking about governance should understand the advantages of having those kinds of flag days occasionally and who could impose one. The answer is, whatever the advantages are, you can forget it today. That's a good thing, probably. We made some transport changes to the mail environment at the same time, developed simultaneously, but the transport environment was sensitive because mail can go from host to host to host across the network, multiple hops. And for those extended features to be used, every one of them had to be upgraded. So the extended features, it turned out, were mostly not very important. Propagated very slowly, working, but that extended environment is still not completely deployed 22 years later. Various embedded machines which send mail are still using the old 30-year-old stuff. Next example, which some of you know about, internationalized domain names. The attempted innovation came along and used local character sets, no tagging, didn't interoperate among friends, ran into some design deficiencies with DNS, involved some nasty comparison problems in characters other than basic Latin, and created for the bad guys out there some attack opportunities. Other than that, it was kind of a roaring success. The second attempt was an effort in the IETF, which gave up on virtually everything that first round of people had tried, other than getting internationalized domain names. The idea was to encode everything to an ASCII-compatible form so the things which worked in ASCII would keep working. And old applications which hadn't been upgraded would not become an obstacle. It involves no changes to DNS. That's another big deployment problem, which I'll talk about a little bit later. And because of the way the thing worked, it was possible to have sliding application transitions rather than, again, having to convert an application all at once for it to deal with internationalized things. It's important to understand that situation to understand what the worst case is, because the worst cases turn out to be the important deployment issues. If Sao Paulo is a DNS label, so is XN-SOPALO-XWA. You don't want to look at that. You don't want to communicate it to your friends. I don't want to read it out loud ever again. But it is better than being in a situation where if the software doesn't know what to do about it, it says, sorry, I have no clue as to what to do. Depending on your operating system, sorry, I have no clue as to what to do is spelled you lose. Or the screen just turned blue. Or some other message that you're not doing anything else useful that day. The method requires conversion before of the actual strings, the native character strings, before going into DNS and conversion back out. It's very painful, it works. And in that regard, it's just like MIME. Bit of pain, but it works. It doesn't require a complete conversion of the entire internet, which is slow and hard. So deployment was very rapid at the second level and below the second level for domains that really wanted and needed it. That's mostly the folks with non-Latin scripts, especially non-European non-Latin scripts. It became especially important and has become widely deployed quickly in places where there's very little use of Latin script in the country. A lot of funny stories about that, but that's another day. Or in situations where the national identity with the language and how it's written correctly is so strong as to overcome technical obstacles. Number of countries where that became important. Again, as with MIME, there was no prior mechanism that worked. There was a prior mechanism in this case, it just didn't work. And no changes needed to DNS. We didn't have to start replacing DNS servers and resolvers. Next example, much more recent. We started worrying about email addresses. There's a case to be made that we shouldn't have to worry about email addresses, that it's all vanity and we should stick with ASCII forms. But people want email addresses in their native scripts. Especially, again, when those scripts are very different from Latin scripts. So that those of you who are not familiar with the technology know what I'm talking about. When we talk about email addresses, we talk about a local part, followed by the at sign, followed by a domain part. They sort of look alike, but the rules for them are entirely different, and they're entirely different for fundamental ways involving design of the email protocols and how things work, necessarily work. Lots of bad experiences trying to do things differently. And because of some of those differences, one can't encode the local part the way IDNA is encoded. You have to transmit it in native character form of some variety. So we went back and used this SMTP extension mechanism from 20 years previously, that, as I mentioned, had not been used very much, except for cases where one could ignore it. It's called SMTP UTF-8, if you ever hear that name. And there are three important cases. There's the all ASCII case, the ASCII local part case with a non-ASCII domain name. We know a lot about those from IDNs. And a non-ASCII local part with either ASCII or non-ASCII domains. So as I started to mention earlier, there's some fundamental questions of why you'd want to bother doing this. Those questions get more intense as you understand the problems. Given that we have had, since the MIME work came in, a way to write the name phrase, the personal name, in any script you like. So this is strictly about the address part. So as I mentioned earlier, there are three important and very different cases, which I will look at one at a time. The first one involves ASCII addresses, both local and domain part. The second and third are the two more slightly more complicated cases. For the first case, you need MIME, because the MIME specs as a side effect specified a way of dealing with non-ASCII personal names. Having the MUAs, the mail user agents, at both ends upgraded is probably a good idea, but there are ways around it. People get used to the gibberish or people decode. And that's been in common use since 1992. Second case, you've got to have IDNA support at least the sending mail user agent. Because if you don't, the sending mail user agent takes a look at that address with a non-ASCII domain and it says that's not a valid address and that's the end of your sending the message. It needs, as the NIC has undoubtedly found out, upgraded domain registrations. Otherwise, you can't get this in DNS in the first place. But it's been available in lots of places since around 2004. The encoded form, the ACE form, the so-called Punycode form, goes on the wire. No real problems. The final case is we've got a non-ASCII part in the local part, non-ASCII string in the local part. And that's a big deal. It's a big deal because prior to 3 years ago, every single mail handling program on the internet was convinced that if it saw a non-ASCII string in that local part, that it was an invalid address or a criminal act and should get rid of it. Attempted criminal act. So standards were finally completed after some experiments and years of arguments and discussion in 2012, 2013. And there has been very little production deployment if you count by countries. And the reason is that passing these non-ASCII strings requires that every one of these mail programs, which has been certain for 30 years, that there was no such thing as a non-ASCII mail local part, has to be upgraded to understand what to do with them. And has to be upgraded to understand that when a request comes through which says we're about to send you one of those, that it has to say yes. We had the extension mechanism. If we hadn't, this would have been hopeless. But that extension mechanism had been lying around for 20 years, not used for this. So with the extension, those mail handling programs know what to do with non-ASCII addresses. The old ones rejected as invalid syntax, new ones can handle it. And as I said, you really can't encode the local part. That's another long discussion and a technical issue. Because I've been worried a lot about internationalization and it affects you and affects where the internet is headed. An observation about trade-offs. The more we internationalize, the more we get accessibility to the internet for people whose native script is not Latin-based, especially, and for people whose native language, primary language is not English. But at the same time, the more fragmentation we get, making it easier to communicate within Portugal makes it harder to communicate between Portugal and everywhere else. Making it easier to communicate within China makes it harder to communicate between China and everybody else. Most of you speak at least some English, and you write Latin script, of course. The Chinese speak less English and do not write Latin script. But the nightmare is localizing things so the Chinese are communicating entirely in Chinese with Chinese addresses, and the Arabs are communicating entirely in Arabic using Arabic addresses, and they simply cannot talk to each other, and if they see each other's addresses, they can't read them, much less type them in. This is one of the things we keep forgetting about the internet and innovation on the internet, which is that this ends up being all about trade-offs. Some things get better, some things get worse. It's important to think about those issues and make rational choices. The advantage of internationalization is it enables more local content and more local communication. Translation is possible unless you get protocol barriers. The email address situation can be a protocol barrier. We run into a different version of the same problem as we look at the network. If we've got one interconnected network, dumb computers, not very smart computers in terms of languages, mnemonics, acronyms, codes, ways of talking about these things do not translate well. One of the things that ICANN almost figured out the hard way very early in its work on new top-level domains is you think com is a word, like an abbreviation for commercial, and you think biz is a word, like abbreviation for business, that there are some languages in which those are the same word. And if you think those distinctions are important, you're in big trouble. That almost turned into a big flap. I can dodge that bullet, unlike all the other bullets. And in particular, when we have things we call protocol elements, the things which are used within the protocols to talk with each other, internationalizing them tends to be a bad idea, even though people would like it. So coming back to the email example, when are we likely to see wide deployment of internationalized email? Remember, this is not filling a vacuum. Non-internationalized email addresses work. Internationalized mail content works. So I don't own a crystal ball, and the last one I owned didn't work very well, and I junked it. But having an innovation which has to be supported in the entire internet path or it will fail is not a good working model. In this particular case, all of the other working models were worse, but it's still not a good working model. When we have specific national or language communities who need to communicate within those communities, this stuff is deploying rapidly and working very well. Right now, that translates as China. And China. And whoops, China. That's the long list. There's activity in Thailand. There's a little bit of activity in Russia. No serious deployment yet. There is discussion, but no real activity, as far as I know, in any of the Arabic countries, and that is about it so far. Sorry, Ukraine as well as Russia. Ukraine may be ahead of Russia. Intercommunity, Chinese try to talk to the Arabs. We're going to be using ASCII forms for a very long time because of those limitations, which have at least as much to do with people as with protocols. We can't forget we're trying to serve people at the end of this process. And that means that most people who correspond internationally are either going to stick with ASCII addresses or they're going to have to maintain two addresses for a very long time, one ASCII and one in their native script. And they're going to have to manage those things and manage mailboxes and aliases with those things, which may not turn out to be easy. We don't know. User interface stuff is research, not internet protocols. So because I couldn't resist it, one more example. We have this puppy we call the domain name system. It was designed for dealing with a very specific set of name to address and name to other kinds of network object mappings. Uniqueness was very important. We controlled allocations in the early days so that you could not own two domain names with the same resource. And that was considered important. But we've been using domain names in a commercial environment more or less ever since we started publicly promoting the web, and people thought that was a good idea. And when something new comes along that requires a global database, the answer is always use the DNS. Because it's there. Sometimes it's a good answer, sometimes it's a bad answer, but it's almost always the answer. The DNS is not very well suited for some of those things. It is a strict hierarchy which was designed for depth. It does some things very badly. It does not do aliases well. Some of the problems with aliases sneak up on us and cause security compromises. And some of those changes may weaken the DNS's basic function. We do not know how to fix it. We know how to keep patching it, but every patch makes things a little bit worse. There's only one real solution, it's to replace the DNS protocol. Not a very big innovation, we basically know how to do it. New model will probably support better aliasing, that has turned out to be important. Better data distribution model, no more arguments about 13 root servers and their shadows. Better ways to deal with non-ASCII characters than this encoding and decoding kludge, although may not be able to do a lot better due to the characters, not the DNS or its successor. Better ways to deal with volatile or localized data. The DNS is designed for very slow synchronization. People coming in and wanting things to change in units of seconds are a threat to DNS stability, even if they can make it work. And as a byproduct, if we were redesigning this today, we would redesign it without a single root hierarchy, which requires arguments about who gets to do what in the root. That's the solution to the transition question, not getting better at solving those arguments. Again, network solutions, governance problems, like many other things, to route around them. Unfortunately, as I said, while a next generation DNS is not especially hard to design, major innovations for the internet, but not for database theory and other things which we've had lying around. It's not even especially hard to implement. Chances of deployment about zero. Why? Well, first of all, it's hard to think about the transition and how you'd manage that because this requires an upgrade path for every DNS server and resolver in the world. That's your desktop. And there's some interesting global economic and political issues that people are making lots of money on domain name system or expect to make lots of money on domain name system very soon are not particularly enthused about something that would undermine their business models or undermine the choice models or undermine the competition models on which their assumptions about how they're going to make money are based. So that's the other side of the innovation story, is the thing which we know, where we know how to innovate, where the innovation is important, and we simply do not know how to do it. Not for technical reasons, but for deployment reasons. The bigger the internet gets, the harder this becomes. So it was probably impossible 10 years ago. Internet has gotten much bigger. It is probably more impossible now. I don't know how you measure that impossibility. So if you're going to try to innovate on the internet, you want to try to find a vacuum to fill. Applications are much easier in that regard than infrastructure because fads work and because there are more vacuums out there. But there may be not a lot of vacuums around. There are these hidden prerequisites and impediments. We did not realize when the Engelbart work was going on in the 70s that the problem was going to turn out to be the absence of modems which could accommodate speeds above 20K. We certainly didn't anticipate when we designed the SMTP extensions that we would still be dealing in 2015 with legacy embedded applications which hadn't upgraded and never will. There's another problem which again gets to the human part. When people are used to a particular thing, even if it's bad but tolerable, what you know already is better. Learning something else is hard unless you have been so irritated by the other thing that you really want to make a change to anything at all. So either the new system has to be lots and lots better or the old system has to be really bad to get a replacement in. Changing and upgrading every host on the internet is hard, and it gets harder because the hosts get added faster than you can upgrade them. And there are economic incentives to do nothing, always. If you don't understand those issues and you're trying to deploy an innovation, deployment has a tendency to be painful, slow, probably unsuccessful. On the other hand, if you can hit the sweet spot, or your goals are to deploy something and make a lot of money very quickly, before people figure out what's wrong with it, and quickly varies, these can be advantages rather than challenges. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Agora vou apresentar o segundo palestrante, professor Anupam Chandler. É diretor do California International Law Center, é professor de Direito da Universidade da Califórnia, é um especialista em cyber law e propriedade intelectual, e a sua pesquisa está focada na regulação da globalização e digitalização. Seu novo livro, The Electronic Silk Road, How the Web Binds the World Together in Commerce, foi lançado em junho de 2013 pela Yale University Press. Anupam explora o comércio global na internet, que agora é regulado, e por que a regulamentação é importante para os indivíduos, bem como para as nações, e como melhores leis podem incentivar o comércio internacional ao mesmo tempo em que protegem os direitos humanos e o direito nacional. Welcome, Anupam.
First of all, thank you very much, Professor Glaser. And congratulations to CGI.br on your 20th anniversary. 20 years ago, in 1995, I was alive then, and most of you were as well. And I remember the coming of the internet. I got the internet, actually, to my house first in 1995. So that was the exact moment that marks my own kind of history with personal internet connections. It's a remarkable history that CGI.br has. It tracks to the very start of the internet in terms of being available commercially. And so this is your professors, your leaders have been at the very forefront of thinking about these issues from the start. And it's an honor for me to address you on one of the principles of the CGI.br. So I will talk about innovation as it connects to the law. And I will pick up very much on John's earlier remarks. John gave us a very important technical history of the internet, of the protocols that make the internet possible, about the web, the email protocols, the domain name system that make the internet work and give it all the power that it has today. What I want to do is step back into the time around 1995 and ask the question, what were the things that made the internet prosper, in particular in the United States, that were not mirrored around the world and that led to, I suggest, the success, particularly of American internet companies as platforms for the world? Okay, so that's the challenge I'm going to offer today. By the way, you can follow me on Twitter here, and you can email me with questions and disputes, et cetera, and challenges right here. Okay, and I also thank Professor Glaser for mentioning my book. You can also get my book, which is not available in Portuguese, but is readily available in English. Okay, so CGI, principle number five, innovation. This is an English translation. Internet governance must promote the continuous development and widespread dissemination of new technologies and models for access and use. My question this evening, how does a nation support innovation? Okay. And my suggestion is, the way I will try to answer that is in particular with respect to the law. By the way, this is an image borrowed from CGI itself. I'm sure Professor Glaser will recognize this image. So the particular question I want to pose is, what explains the rise of Silicon Valley? We're told very often that it's the coincidence of money, of venture capital in Silicon Valley, and the educational institutions in Silicon Valley, particularly Stanford and the University of California's in the area. But education and money coincide in many places around the world. They exist, for example, right here. This is a very wealthy city, and there are lots of highly educated people in this very city. So I want to suggest two other important factors in this story. One is culture, which I won't actually discuss this evening, but I want to focus instead, as I've said, on law. So my focus will not be on what you would expect. When we talk about the law of innovation, people automatically assume that the subject is patent law. And I will suggest instead the law of innovation is to be found in a different space with respect to the internet. And that is because the internet is first and foremost, as is evident from Professor Clensen's presentation, a medium of communication. And therefore, the law regulating communication turns out to be the principal legal infrastructure to support internet innovation. Okay, so that's the argument I'm going to make. So instead of patent law, I'll focus on intermediary liability. I'll talk a little bit about privacy. And what I want to do is, the way I'll proceed is this. I'll begin with talking about the United States. Then I'll look at what the European Union did at a similar time. Then I'll step far across the world to South Korea and Japan, which had very high technical broadband implementation very early. So their internet infrastructure, the hard routers and wires, were built out very early. I won't talk about, because you're quite familiar with the Brazilian approach, which has been changed dramatically over the last year. So you're very familiar with this, and I won't discuss it here, but we can talk about how it fits in this during the question and answers. Okay, so let's begin with the United States. I want to suggest three legs to the stool of U.S. internet infrastructure law. First, in the realm of copyright. When many of you hear the words DMCA, you shudder. Okay, it represents all that's bad. It makes it hard to tinker with things, to decrypt and figure out how reverse engineer things. It creates problems for computer scientists and engineers. But there's another part of the DMCA that gets much less attention, which is the DMCA Title II. And what the DMCA Title II did was it said that if you have someone who posts something on your website or through your service, and that thing infringes the copyright of a third party, the web host is not going to be held liable for that copyright infringement unless the web host is notified by the copyright holder under oath and then refuses to take it down despite being notified and receiving this notice under oath. Okay, so that is the notice and takedown regime that the copyright system offers, that the DMCA Title II implements. It creates what are called safe harbors for copyright infringement. It creates this notice and takedown regime, as I've said. So that's the first leg of this stool. The second leg of this stool is something called the Communications Decency Act, Section 230. This is one very short provision in this statute. The bulk of the statute was actually struck down by the Supreme Court in a 1997 ruling. Okay. But the part of the statute that survived turned out to be a key to the success of the internet for the next 20 years. And that is immunity from liability for intermediaries for defamation and other civil torts. Okay. So both these statutes essentially had a fundamental realization. They were based on a fundamental insight, which was when you give people tools, most of them will use those tools for perfectly legal things. There will be a small fraction of people who will use those tools for illegal activity. So the question is whether you hold the tool maker liable for those illegal activities by those users. And both of these statutes said no. In most circumstances, the answer will be no. Okay. A third important and very controversial aspect of US law, okay, and all these are controversial, I don't mean to say single this out as the only thing that's controversial, is that the US law did not create new special privacy laws to regulate the internet. There was a little bit with respect to children, the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, but in general, what the United States did was enforce privacy policies that were instituted by companies. It enforced them and created settlements with companies like Google and Facebook of 20-year audits of their privacy practices, for example. Okay, so this was the U.S. approach, and I want to show you this in operation, the importance of this setup, in the following way. Sorry. So consider three companies: Facebook, Amazon, and does anyone recognize this? Pinterest, right? Probably half of you could recognize this, but probably in a couple of years, 60% and then 70% as these things grow. Okay. This first is Amazon with this little smiling face. So you think of Amazon, how could it rely upon this infrastructure? It's just selling goods, okay? It's selling hard things. I know it's also selling ebooks and more digital media, but fundamentally it's moving solid goods. So why does it need any kind of that framework that I described earlier? Well, one of the key values of Amazon is the reviews that users leave on the website of all the products that it sells. Okay? But just think about the mischief that one can do with those reviews. Okay? So those reviews allow anyone an open-ended box to describe or criticize, ridicule, or perhaps malign or defame that product and its authors and its owners, right? So it gives you an open-ended platform in which to complain or approve of a particular product. So Amazon, of course, was sued because when an author would be criticized, attacked, he would then say to Amazon, take down the critical review. Okay, the first thing, I am being defamed, the author would claim. And imagine an Amazon, a review system, where anyone who had anything negative posted about them could ask that review to be removed, okay, on the grounds that it was defamatory. Right? Because that would be the end product of this. And what would Amazon do? Well, worried about a defamation lawsuit, it would remove the material. So imagine a review system that only said good things. Right? It's not a very useful review system. It essentially boils down to counting the number of likes that you might have for a particular product. Right? So, and I'll walk through a particular case to show you an example of this. So Amazon was sued. So a person named Jerome Schneider sued Amazon for what he said was a defamatory review, okay? Amazon refused to take it down. He sued Amazon, okay? And this went to the courts. And so in the courts, Amazon prevailed. Amazon prevailed because of the Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act. A very simple, open and shut case. Amazon was not writing the review. It was simply republishing and making available what other users had provided. Okay. Now, imagine if it had adopted a notice and takedown regime that mirrored the one for copyright. Okay, so I know that the lawyers in the room are certainly thinking this question, right? So that would make, so what would Amazon do then if it had a notice and takedown regime? So Section 230, and a very, you know, this is gonna be technical lawyer stuff, is different than the DMCA Title II. DMCA Title II described a notice and takedown regime. Section 230 doesn't require takedown at all, even if you are notified of the alleged wrong. Okay. But think about this. Amazon is informed by Mr. Schneider, I am being defamed. So what should Amazon do? Should it then, acting under a notice and takedown regime, it would say, okay, we'll take it down. I've been notified of the defamation. But how does Amazon know what is the truth about Mr. Schneider or his book? Amazon has no way to be the judge of that question, right? So it would, in a notice and takedown regime, it would automatically take everything down, except the most preposterous claims. That would be the end result. So the end result of a notice and takedown regime in this context would in fact be exactly what I described earlier, which would be a review system where you only say good things about a product. This book was great. That would not be a very valuable system, right? So Amazon's database of reviews turns out to be a huge asset. One of the reasons that people shop on Amazon. There's a lot of other great things about why people shop on Amazon or on other sites, so I'm not saying that's the only asset that it has, but this legal infrastructure allowed a ratings and a review system to develop that protected the companies from being held liable for the mischief that would ultimately happen with reviews. I looked up what Mr. Schneider's books look like today, and this is the one review of his book available today. Okay, a one-star review by someone who says the author was recently convicted of defrauding the U.S. government. Okay, I have no idea if any of that is true, but neither does Amazon. And Mr. Schneider clearly hasn't actually been able to go after Roger Lathbury actually is, even though the legal system allows him to do so, to uncover the identity of this person and to challenge this person directly. Okay. So that's case one. Case two, Facebook. And I love this, which is that Mark Zuckerberg has what he calls Zuckerberg's Law, okay, which will sound very familiar to the computer scientists in the room, which every year people will share twice as much information as they shared the year before. Just think about your own lives. I don't know if that's true for you, but I wonder if it's true for me. I actually think maybe yes. You know, it's a really wonderful insight into how much more information is being shared. Okay, but this information sharing process, this what Zuckerberg's site does is it allows people to write information and then to share information freely. Okay, obviously it relies upon the fact that it is able to monetize by advertising to you more directly now that it knows exactly what kinds of stuff you like. Okay. Facebook knows what websites you're visiting if those websites are connected to the Facebook platform. If those websites have a like button on them, not only can you see the like button can see you. That process allows for Facebook to provide a service that now covers, you know, more than a billion people in the world, right? And with internet.org and other means, they hope to expand that reach even further. Third, Pinterest. Now think about Pinterest. What for those who, for the few of you who, for the 50% of you who don't know Pinterest, Pinterest basically gives you a tool that allows you to pin anything you find on the web to your bulletin board on Pinterest. Okay, so you can take this tool and say I like. It's basically used for images. I like this image and post that to your page. In essence, it's a giant copying machine for the web. Okay. Professor Clenson mentioned permissionless innovation. Does Pinterest ask the website if it can copy that particular image? No. Right? And it doesn't have to, again, because if you look back, if you think about it, that's the DMCA Title II at work, invisibly. Okay, so remember what I said with the DMCA Title II. It said users can copy and do things and infringe copyrights, but the proprietor of the service is not to be held liable until the proprietor of the service is informed about a specific infringement and then does not take down that specific infringing material. Okay, again, under a notice provided under oath. So in other words, Pinterest is not held liable for the copyright infringement of its users unless it's notified of the particular infringement. And it can, therefore, whenever it's told, hey, this image is being pinned on this page, that's a pretty easy algorithmic task to just remove that from that page, right? So in 2012, the Japanese firm Rakuten led a $100 million investment into Pinterest when Pinterest was about a year old, okay? Now, Pinterest technology is not particularly amazing. Okay, anyone can basically create tools that will allow you to, select an image, copy them to another page, and put them on that page. Okay, and even add comments and likes and hearts and things like that on that other page. Right, it's nothing hard as a computer science or computer engineering question. So why did Rakuten invest $100 million in a startup in the United States, rather than building this out in Japan? This is the first question, right? Why not just recreate the whole thing? You spend $100 million and you'll have a bigger company. You have more R&D investment than Pinterest has ever put in. Okay. And the reason is, there are a number of answers to that question. You may want the management team of Pinterest. That's a good, Pinterest already has an established user base, et cetera. It has some public, following. But fundamentally, American law said Pinterest was legal. And Japanese law, not so much. Okay. So if you invested $100 million in Japan in the same idea, well, you may be out of luck when the court rules that whole business model of giving a copying machine for the web to the world illegal under domestic copyright law, right? Okay, so, and it turns out, and I've chosen examples that demonstrate this, that free expression and robust debate require the right to criticize others, not just to sing their praises. Okay, so that's what we saw in the Amazon case, for example. And free expression, which is another one of the important principles of CGI.BR, happens to actually find itself to be complementary with the innovation that I'm talking about here. Okay, so the end result is that we support both free expression and economic development. And US-based startups attract venture capital because fundamentally their business model is legal in the United States. Okay. And you may say, let me just back up for a second. You may say, oh, this all seems so obvious, and the United States just makes great rules and knows what it's doing. Not so much. Part of this is a little bit of accident, and a lot of it is the fortuity of a strong commitment to free expression. I want to give you an example, just a funny example from the debates in 1995. Okay. Here, Ron Wyden, who basically was the principal champion of Section 230, another congressperson intervenes. She says, "I wish to engage a gentleman from Oregon, Mr. Wyden. Mr. Chairman, I strongly support the gentleman's efforts, but telephone companies must inform us as to whom our long-distance calls are made." Some of you young people may not remember this moment at all, but we used to get long lists of exactly what long-distance telephone calls you made. And she asked for the same list of all the URLs you visited. Okay. And she wanted this to be in the statute mandating what ISPs would provide when they sent their billing statement. Okay. So this was thankfully not implemented, but you can see that, you know, we had lots of ideas at this time. We luckily chose a few that worked well for us, but it might well have gone a totally different way. Okay. All right. So I'm now going to look at the European Union, and I'll, you know, give a thumbnail sketch of some of the issues. There's more discussion of this in my book and additional papers that you can find on the web. If you go to SSRN, if you Google my name with SSRN, you can download a lot of papers that are open access. All right. European Union. And here I'm going to talk about exposure for intermediaries and less flexibility in copyright. Okay? Less exceptions, less flexible exceptions in copyright. And strict privacy rules, which you are familiar with. Okay. Okay, so let's look at the first. Even while the European Union passed directives that said, no, internet service providers, internet online services do not have an obligation to monitor what happens on their service, with the same breath, they said they might have, quote, duties of care. Now you may ask yourself, what are duties of care? And that's exactly what everyone else puzzled about. What are duties of care? How do I know how careful I have to be with what's happening on my system? Is that really a monitoring obligation? Do I have to monitor what's happening on my system, what people are saying? And if I'm not monitoring it, if I'm not careful enough, will I be liable for what happens through my system, right? And in terms of flexibility and copyright, so this is a wonderful statement by Prime Minister Cameron. Prime Minister Cameron says that the Google founders, Larry Page and Sergey Brin, told him that they could not have founded Google in London. This wasn't because of lack of money, lack of talent. They said, according to Cameron, to Prime Minister Cameron, it was because of UK copyright law. Okay? And UK copyright law did not have room for what Google has to do, which is, as you computer scientists know, as the computer scientists among you know, first, in order to create an efficient search engine, you've got to index what is to be searched. That indexing process, Google's founders told Prime Minister Cameron, essentially required making a copy of things on the web. In a sense, making a copy of the entire web. Okay. And that would be potentially a violation of UK copyright law. Whereas in the United States, that was totally acceptable. It was a transformative use that would be permissible under standing doctrines of fair use in the United States. So he says, Prime Minister Cameron explained, they have what are called fair use provisions, which some people believe gives companies breathing space to create new products and services. The way that many jurisdictions function is that the exceptions that are created for the copyright are ones written in the statute reflecting what prior users had done. When you're thinking of innovation, you're using something in ways that have never been done before. Okay, so if you have a historical view of what the exception should be, you're often going to miss the new uses that technology allows. Okay, and American fair use turns out to be very flexible, turns out to be about principles. Is it about these kinds of goals? And therefore allows the technology and the technologists to create new things without worrying that they are going to be in violation of copyright law. Okay. So now turn to privacy. You've all heard about the right to be forgotten. Okay. And I want to criticize, and this is just the latest example of a longstanding tradition in the European Union of creating special obligations for internet enterprises with respect to privacy. Okay. Going back at least to 1995's Data Protection Directive. But I'm just going to just look at the latest version just for the interest in that it has created. So the right to be forgotten, as many of you are quite familiar with the implementation of this, but essentially what it says is that you can ask a search engine, okay, to remove a link from its search results if it is considered inadequate, no longer relevant, etc., okay, or excessive. And that standard, who sits in judgment of that, of whether or not this information is too old, etc.? It turns out to be the law requires Google to sit in judgment of whether or not this is excessive, etc. Okay. A bizarre outsourcing of normative decisions to a corporation. And Google actually has routinely said no to the right to be forgotten requests. The right to be forgotten does not mean that the original information can be removed from the web, at least as implemented currently in Europe, right? It only means that you can't, that Google or Bing or Baidu can no longer index that information and provide that ultimate link to the web page that has that information. Okay. And Google has published statistics on exactly what it's done. So I'm going to try to finish in another 5 minutes I'll be quick here. So it's denied it 60% of the time. And it turns out that the newspapers hate the right to be forgotten. So when a link is pulled from Google, the Telegraph republishes and says, hey, it republishes a new story about the old story that is no longer linked to. So these people suffer the humiliation one more time. And so here's I just picked a couple of the things that have been removed. So a vicar who resigned after villagers accused him of standing naked at a vicarage window, an email following his arrest. And you can go back, they link directly back to the original sites, okay, which Google can no longer link to, but the Telegraph can still telegraph them to the world. Okay. Most importantly, okay, most importantly, that's just a funny incident, I think. Most importantly is that, again, going back to my Amazon example, finding truth becomes more difficult when that truth is negative, right? This allows people to whitewash, potentially, their own past. And that is a problem, I think, in terms of speech. Okay, the end result, the European Union's law, it's largely futile, it undermines free expression, and it's friendly fire and local innovation. Because again, Google couldn't be established in the UK. You couldn't create huge databases that index everything freely within Europe, etc. Right? So let's quickly turn to South Korea, and I'm not going to go through this I'll just summarize this. So in South Korea, again, notions of high responsibility on intermediaries. Okay, so we see this, when Steve Jobs, however, when he offered the iPod in 2001, he allowed it to play MP3s. Sony, when it offered the digital Walkman, okay, with a hard disk inside, did not allow it to play MP3s. Why? Because where did MP3s come from in 2001? They largely came from Napster. Okay, and Sony didn't want Napster catalogs moved over to its hard drive. Well, Apple said, we don't ask where your MP3s are coming from. Okay, Sony had a very very particular scheme. This is how you had to show the legitimate way that you had that digital file. Okay, that was the only way you could get it on or off that machine. Okay. And the Constitutional Court observed in 2012, look, there exist communication networks where our law doesn't apply, thereby causing domestic users to flee to foreign websites. Okay. A simple insight by the South Korean Supreme, the Constitutional Court, I should say, that could be borrowed in other jurisdictions as well, if I were to be so bold to suggest. And then let me look at Japan. In 2004, he's arrested for what does he do? He puts up on the web a file sharing system called Winnie. Okay, it's a P2P file sharing system. And his crime, keeping on distributing the file sharing system, even though he knew that some people were using it for copyright infringement. Under that standard, Steve Jobs would be spending 100 years in jail. Okay, and he was convicted at the trial court. He was, he won on appeal. But the prosecutor then appealed that, the overturning of the verdict, and he had to fight it all the way to the Supreme Court of Japan, and he only won in 2011. So he spent the rest of the decade, instead of being the amazing programmer creating amazing products, he spent the rest of the decade fighting so. People around this time said to Japanese programmers, I advise you to release your software abroad. And remember when I talked about Google search engine in the UK? Google and Yahoo placed their search servers outside Japan. They served Japan in Japanese, but they placed the servers outside Japan because the search servers may well have been illegal under Japanese copyright law. What is that but friendly fire on economic development, right? It's your own law that is harming you. Okay, so I'll conclude very quickly here. In sum, where the United States approached the internet with hope, the rest of the world approached it with fear. Okay, heightening liabilities. with end result, and here again I borrowed a CGI.PR image, with contemporary communications technologies, I think the fundamental thing we should recognize with is that free speech has become an industrial policy. It turns out to undergird innovation and domestic growth in a world of rapid communications and better technologies. All right, I will end there. Thank you again. Congratulations. Thank you.
Depois dessas duas excelentes palestras, nós vamos ter momento de dúvidas, perguntas e respostas. Temos microfones à disposição, temos tradução, então pode ser em português sem problema nenhum. Quem quer começar? Eu só peço que diga o seu nome e a quem está dirigida a pergunta.
Thank you both for this position. My name is Mark from the State University of São Paulo. I study intellectual property, so I'd like to talk to Professor Anupam. My question is this. You mentioned about intellectual property and the right to be forgotten, and a trend that has been going on is that the copyright industry has been removing links from search engines as a tactic to drive away traffic from illegal files. And to me, it seems that it's a lot. It works a lot like the right to be forgotten, in the sense that Google ends up being the stakeholder that has to take the action to mitigate the infraction. And so I'd like to ask, how do you see the difference between the action of these laws in the context that it's being used so in such strength by the copyright industry?
So it's a great question. So the copyright industry has certainly been abusive often with respect to its copyright notices. So this is a serious problem. They would go after children, and they would go after people who were with very little actual wrongdoing that they were attacking. But I do think it makes the system in the United States, where they have a notice and takedown regime that's available to them, seems to be one that companies have been able to live with. It seems largely to have reduced the incidence of the most. It's reduced the incidence of the most obvious websites that would host these things. Okay, certainly it has not eliminated piracy by any stretch of the imagination. There's a ton of piracy, so I think the piracy, of course, results largely because the copyright industries themselves have been very dilatory, very slow in embracing the new technologies. Okay, so this has been a huge problem, I think, in general. So I appreciate the worry that the copyright industries can use these things in abusive ways. That's why I mentioned, for example, the oath requirement for the notices. I think that's very important in a notice and takedown regime. Most jurisdictions, when they have a notice and takedown regime, do not have that requirement. I think that's a very nice constraint on the notice and takedown system. But I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you for the answer. Outra pergunta, next question.
Professor Chander, you said that due to stricter copyright
your
laws...
Your name, please, your name.
Pedro.
Pedro, from?
UFMG.
Okay, University in Minas Gerais, Belo Horizonte.
You said that due to stricter copyright laws in the UK and the EU, innovation was somehow slowed down there, right? You think that with the Trans-Pacific Partnership Treaty that has been discussed between the United States and South Korea and many other states will cause an overall decrease in innovation in those countries, or due to the upper position of the United States involving these countries with lower scientific development, the United States will retain this position of leadership in innovation?
That's a great question. So what will the result of the Trans-Pacific Partnership be on the smaller, less developed, less economically advanced countries in the world? It's not exactly clear what the copyright provisions of the TPP will ultimately be. There may well be efforts to introduce DMCA Title II style protections for internet platforms in the TPP, okay, which I think would actually help innovation around the world. So the really important thing to recognize here is that the biggest companies in the world, like Facebook and Google, et cetera, and Microsoft, they have the fortitude to withstand a lot of attacks and obligations. It's the small companies, the new startups, that actually face the worst time with all the legal exposure. Okay, the big companies have legal teams that will fight these things to the death, and often and generally win. The small guys will just will just fold, right, in the face of lawsuits. And I think this is so it's important to recognize that. But your question is with respect to the TP in particular. So certainly, if you have greater integration of economies that freer trade through something like a TPP, you'll have the possibility of more commerce between the jurisdictions. And your fear in that context is, does the advanced, technologically advanced nation always win then? And therefore, the less advanced nations always lose. I'm not sure. I don't think that's inevitable. In this case, a lot of the technologies are not particularly high technologies, but they're innovations that are like just like Pinterest or you know the latest games, etc. They aren't not necessarily hugely technological huge technological challenges, but rather great ideas that are implemented really well. And there's no reason to think that those ideas can't come out of the smaller nations, the Vietnams, the Philippines, the Brazils, et cetera, of the world. Brazil is not a small nation. That's the wrong word to use. The less economically advanced nations of the world than the United States. So I'm actually quite hopeful about the 20 years into the internet is very young. We'll see what happens 50 years from now. That's when you'll be looking back and surveying this history and wondering, how various countries and companies became as big as they did.
Thank you. Lá atrás, por favor. Seu nome?
So, hi, I'm Carlos Afonso from the State University of Rio. A very quick and easy question. Do you all think, and it's a question to the both of you, do you think that zero rating programs, such as dealing with net neutrality issue, is it inducive of innovation? Do you see the future of the internet with all the innovation that you all have mentioned, including zero rating programs as the ones that we have nowadays? So it's just that. Thank you.
Okay, it's a tricky issue, Carlos. It's not an easy one, certainly zero rating, which you're all familiar with, the idea of internet.org, where it provides you a dozen websites that you can visit, principal among them Facebook, and the mobile operator actually pays the data charges. It pays the data charges. Facebook, one of the remarkable things is that people believe that Facebook is providing this free thing to them. It's just providing Facebook platform as it is to it's a kind of a very Facebook light version, data light version of Facebook that the ISP, your mobile operator, is actually carrying without charge to Facebook, right? So certainly when you consider in the context of innovation, you think of the dozen websites that it offers. That looks like television 50 years ago. It doesn't look like the internet today, right? How do you get to be among the dozen or two dozen? How many sites will be available in this scheme? How do you come into this? I think it is a challenge for innovation. I'm also always worried about regulation that shuts down things too quickly. I love the fact that there's a dialogue occurring, that there's the CGI.br, as I understand, sent a letter to Facebook asking a series of questions. And I think that dialogue of figuring out what exactly it's doing, what its plans are, making sure, for example, that they're not all English, two Portuguese sites and then a dozen English sites. To include Brazilian companies and local information would seem to be a natural first step, at least, minimal step, and to allow for Brazilian innovators to be on that platform would be a very important feature, I would think, that any local policy should promote.
John, please.
Yeah, I keep striving for ways to avoid making these things internet problems, which have to be thought about in special ways. And the disadvantage of at least part of what you just suggested is that it provides a formula for Facebook to buy off the appropriate regulators. I think Brazil is lucky because the appropriate regulators may be hard to buy off. I know other jurisdictions in which regulators are pretty cheap. I think there's some important questions that one could ask. If, for example, Facebook were told that anybody they want to offer a free service to, they should simply mail a check every month in some appropriate amount for subsidizing their internet connections, it would make the motivations of the relationships much more clear. But this is one of those situations in which the door is being opened a crack by some possibly well-intentioned, possibly not, mechanism for dealing with different internet traffic differently. And that's a risk, whether that particular issue is a problem or not. It sets precedence for doing other things which we might agree are problematic. So these things worry me, whether they worry me because of net neutrality or because they open a door or because the economic motivation and models are being deliberately hidden behind other things. Maybe a different set of questions, but I am a little concerned about it.
If I can add one more word on that, Carlos. And this is not my line, but I'm going to use it. Internet.org is neither the internet nor a .org, right? And so it's important to recognize that and to realize the reality of that. That doesn't mean we get rid of it, but it does. We have to understand exactly what's happening.
Thank you. Other questions, please? Seu nome?
Lieutenant Colonel Lopes Carneiro from Cyber Defense Center. My question is for Mr. John. I would like to know, how would you analyze the impacts of the points of innovation you mentioned under the cyber defense or cybersecurity perspective?
I should tell you first that this is part of a range of questions which I usually try to make certain somebody else answers so I don't have to. I'm very skeptical for some of the same reasons you're skeptical about internet-specific regulation in other areas, about internet-specific regulation in so-called cybersecurity areas. In most countries, we have pretty good laws about various things which are considered criminal behavior. Where we don't, we ought to or ought to know how to fix that. And we've typically got pretty good rules about how to enforce our rules against criminal behavior. So the first half of the cybersecurity question often turns out to be one of, is this criminal behavior under normal law? Can we construe it as criminal behavior under normal law? Rather than trying to make special internet rules. And where the special internet rules start to come up, very similar issue because things are inherently crossing back and forth across international boundaries, we've again got centuries of precedent in how to deal with criminal activity crossing international boundaries. The most important historical one tends to be piracy on the high seas. And while I wouldn't encourage finding internet criminals who are crossing international boundaries and hanging them from the nearest yardarm, it would certainly be a powerful deterrent. The difficulty with making specific laws in a rapidly changing technology area, and speaking much more as a political scientist than as an attorney, because I am not the latter, is that the laws never keep up. We end up with the technology changing, the law is always written to the previous technology, and those very specific laws turn out not to be specific to today's problem or tomorrow's problem, however relevant they were to yesterday's problem. So I have tended to try to think about these things as much as possible in terms of established rules, established treaties, established agreements, and how those rules and treaties and agreements can be adapted, adjusted if necessary, but not made specific to some particular internet technology. The spam problem turns out to be the one of the best examples of this and one of the ones we've handled the most badly. And I'll talk more about that if you want me to take the time, or I'll just stop here.
Thank you. Mais alguém?
I'm Diego from CGI advisory team, and I will touch on a topic which deals with what Professor Clancy said in relation to the innovation in the domain name system. And I think it has a lot to do with the topic of freedom of expression, which was part of the one of the positive aspects that was presented by Dr. Chander in relation to the US framework. Very recently in the new GTLD program in ICANN, Amazon tried to open the .amazon, and there was huge controversy, and Brazil, Peru, and other countries could stall the development of that specific application. So no .amazon. But very recently, 1 month ago, a group of congressists in the United States, they tried to reopen the question of .amazon. And they are trying to use the IANA transition as a power leverage to say we should talk about .amazon again, and that will influence the way that we, the Congress of the United States, will delve into our process of evaluating any decision on the IANA process. And they claim that Amazon has the right of freedom of expression in the domain name system. So I would like to get your perception on that sort of a change in the purpose of the domain name system very recently with the domain name system. Thank you.
ICANN has, for a number of reasons, some of them in the interest of competition and making things more open, and other well-intentioned things and some less well-intentioned, has managed to create a very political environment with the domain name system in general and the buying and selling of names. It could have been otherwise. But we've ended up with this very highly politicized environment, and an environment in which typical of such environments, the private sector especially, the distorting effects of money are very considerable. John Postel and I had a conversation around 1988 that he started, and it had already to do with questions about who was more entitled to which name than somebody else in some second level domain. And that was the time that John suggested, as one of several occasions, that we should create a new set of top level domains named B, C, D, E, F, and so on, up through perhaps Y. And then when somebody came in with an application for a new domain, we should assign it at random to one of those group. And then we should do what has been done with some other internet registries, which was to accept the application but then assign the second level string at random. Because these things are identifiers, they are not supposed to have strong semantic content. When they start getting strong semantic content, they get better as mnemonics, but they invite these controversies about who is more entitled to what name on what basis. The difficulty with these problems is that they cannot be solved in a way which is reasonable and equitable. We sometimes say in the IETF, the difference between the IETF and ICANN is that in the IETF there's general agreement about what happens, about what it is that constitutes success. In ICANN there's no such agreement unless it is, I make more money than he does. I personally believe that this new argument about Amazon is stupid and will go nowhere. I hope I'm right. I also have some personal beliefs in the interests of free expression about the intellectual competence and understanding of internet issues by the US Congress. And I probably can't repeat those thoughts in polite company, free expression or otherwise. I'm very disappointed by a lot of what's going on in the Congress. At the same time, it's important to understand about the US Congress and the US political system, especially right now, that a tremendous amount of things get said in the interest of saying them, or in impressing somebody who has donated a lot of money that you are interested in whatever it is they care about. There's a long history of that, and most of it goes nowhere because its purpose is simply to be quoted in the press as saying those things. So my guess is this will go away. But if you're asking about the fundamental problem is this notion of markets in names and competition in names. And opening up the new GTLD market to anybody who could pay for it and lobby enough people is a cause of this problem at that level, because at a lower level, we would simply say, you want Amazon, you put Amazon in com, nobody will think Amazon.com is the same as Amazon.pe, and we can now all go on our merry way. So if it's clear that I'm a little irritated with ICANN, that's probably correct inference.
Thank you, thank you.
So can I echo that for a second?
And parenthetically, the third example on your list is the current Africa mess.
So I think Mr. Clensen is exactly right here. The issue of free speech, Diego, you're right that the people will say, oh, I have a free speech right to .amazon. It doesn't make sense, right? Because it's claiming a monopoly on speech, in fact, right? It's the opposite of free speech. It's saying, I am the only one who can have this thing, right? It's, you can, if free speech is about the ability to express yourself, right? And if your expression forecloses everyone else's expression, that can't possibly be what free speech requires, right? So I have to totally agree.
There's another piece of this. At one of the earliest ICANN meetings, you might remember, I tried to explain about this notion of somebody owning a name on the internet, which is precisely what you're talking about. And my explanation suggested as human societies, we had figured out what the problem was with this and figured it out a very long time ago. And the example I used is when we were living in caves and discovered language and naming things, that some caveman named Og, who lived in a cave somewhere up in the hills, suddenly discovered that there was a caveman named Og, who lived in a cave down near the river. And what we did as human societies is to figure out that one of them had to be Og at the top of the hill, and the other one had to be Og down by the river. And if we didn't figure this out, the only thing we were going to be able to do was one Og was going to have to kill the other one to eliminate the duplication in names. This is really not a useful argument. It has not been a useful argument for tens of thousands of years. The fact that ICANN wants to cause that argument now shouldn't be any of our problem.
Mais alguém lá atrás, por favor? Nome?
Meu nome é Fátima. Eu gostaria de perguntar para qualquer dos dois se a luta pela diminuição do prazo de validade de copyright e de patentes não seria um passo fundamental para aumentar a liberdade de expressão e a possibilidade de inovação, tanto em hardware quanto em software.
Obrigado.
So, I believe you're correct. Unfortunately, decreasing these terms seems politically unlikely at the moment. The real issue is preventing the increase of the terms, which I think we have to make sure we do, right? And so I don't know politically if that's going to be possible at this point. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't seek to decrease. No one invests, no one writes a novel thinking about or decides whether or not they're going to write a novel, whether or not 150 years from now, someone will bend their children, you know, five generations further on, will benefit from that work. No corporation makes an investment on a 100-year time frame. Okay, even the big corporations that invest billions of dollars in creating a product or opening up, you know, digging a well in the middle of the ocean or whatever, they're expecting returns in the scale of decades, not centuries. So none of this makes sense economically. You're right that it would be better to roll it back, but unfortunately, I'm not sure that the political will is there to make that happen at this moment. But, you know, look, Brazil has done remarkable things in the past, and so I would encourage you to keep that fight up. Thank you.
Mais alguma pergunta? Okay. Thank you very much for question and answers, for the good discussion. I'd like to recognize your participation with two small gifts. Thank you very much for your participation.
Thank you all, and congratulations on 20 years. My internet experience goes back 20 years longer than that, so I hope to see you 20 years from now, celebrating your 40th.
Muito obrigado, pessoal. Boa noite.